Hello and welcome to the Skating Lesson Olympic Ice Dance Edition. Welcome to the show, Emily Tuttle.
Hey, Dave.
Emily, the free dance was upon us. It's my favorite night of the year.
I know.
As always, there's nothing I like more than watching that final flight of the free dance. So let's get into it. I have a lot
Sure.
of feelings about the Olympics, skating, life. I mean, Oprah, whatever. But I want to start with the commentary because there's
Okay.
been so much buzz about Johnny Weir and Tara Lipinski. And in the men's event, people were sending me clips of them because I didn't even know I got the channel because the number changed and now my cable provider has it. I didn't even know. And I thought that they were super funny. But then
Yeah.
we got to the ice dance and I had actually turned it off during the team event. I was trying to listen to the online. They had the free 30-minute thing and I had to turn it off and
Yeah.
do something else. I'm not sure about you, but I was kind of offended that NBC and their cable network had two people who didn't know ice dance commentating the event.
Yes.
And to a certain extent, I don't feel that it is Tara and Johnny's fault. It was a business decision by NBC to put them there and not have Tanith on for whatever reason. But I had to say that I was kind of offended by the event as it was going on, and I found it really disrespectful to ice dance, especially because it's the discipline that is most criticized. So I wanted to know what you thought about their coverage. Because I
Yeah.
could be wrong, you know.
No, I think I'm on board with Tara and Johnny. I think that they're adding a level of spontaneity and the coverage is more fun and there's more energy and they're getting a ton of praise from everybody, I think. But I thought they were noticeably lacking when it came to ice dance. And I thought, well, first of all, the volume of talking was probably 50% too much across the board. And I mean, I just had this image of them like Googling what a finstep was. You know, I didn't feel like there had been a lot of homework done before the event. Not that that would have made all the difference. I mean, Tanith would have been wonderful. Obviously, I think there was probably a conflict of interest thing. And I also think there was an idea that we want to brand Tara and Johnny across the entire event and we want them doing all the live coverage. But I think, you know, I mean, oh my God, Dave, they like Tara would like say things like, I really love this program. This is a great song. And like general costume snark, you know, a lot of that. And, you know, this is already a discipline that suffers a lot, you know, is the butt of all the skating jokes, you know, and I was frustrated with it. They didn't feel like they were taking it seriously.
Yeah.
And as somebody who loves ice dance and is always trying to convince other people that it's important and interesting and valuable and artistic, you know, I thought that was disappointing.
Yeah, I don't have an issue with them at all in the other disciplines. I actually really enjoy them, and I think it's great. I think that they're drawing people into the Olympics.
Yeah.
Whether you like them, you don't like what they say, they're getting people talking, and I think that that's fantastic. And I don't have an issue with snark. But I do have an issue with it feeling like Mystery Science Theater 3000 when the warm-up group is going on and they're making comments that you might make to a friend at, like, Skate Detroit. You know, being like, ooh, we have a Romeo and Juliet over here. I mean, this was the Olympic Games and these people have prepared really hard for this. And I just felt that there was a level of frivolity, you know, and frivolousness instead of really taking it seriously. And I don't know personally. And it's so hard because they didn't know it. And I happen to have a friend that coaches at the ice house and he was an ice dancer and was saying that Johnny came over to him and said that NBC was putting them through ice dance boot camp because they really didn't know anything what a finstep was. And that's understandable, but that's NBC's decision. But I feel like with Johnny's commentary, he's all over the map based on who he's friends with and which Russian coach was at his rink. And it just gets to be a bit much when you're watching it. I don't trust anything that he has to say, especially in ice dance. So I just, it was a little, I was already starting on edge.
I think like Tracy Wilson in primetime, I mean, I think she's under a lot of pressure from NBC to keep it very light on technical analysis and very heavy on personal narrative. You know, you have an hour basically to get to, they have like an hour to explain ice dance once, you know, once every 4 years. You can't really get into levels and deep edges, but she still managed to, you know, sneak in a little bit of information in some of her commentary. Like she did note some small issues with Ilyinich and Katsalapov and others. And so I still felt like, you know, everybody's really down on the primetime commentators. But, I mean, she did an okay job.
I thought she was better than the other nights. I thought that was the best night of commentary was her during the event. I don't know. I thought that it was easy to watch, and I didn't notice the commentary. And I thought maybe that's good when you don't even notice it. It was just the night, and it was pleasant to watch, and I really didn't feel one way or the other, and I felt the same way about Vancouver. But I do want to go into, there's been a ton of controversy about the results here in first and second place, and I think that we knew that this was coming from even before the team event ever started. Davis and White beating Virtue and Moyer, I think we've seen this coming for the last 2 years, and that the level of ire on behalf of the Canadian press coming. So I want to know, first of all, what did you think of the performances? Let's start with that. Sure. Let's start with the actual skating that happened at the event and just go from there.
Oh, it was so exciting. I mean, ice dance, this is like Christmas, but it only comes once every 4 years. I was on edge for like an hour. My heart was beating so fast. I never get like that really when I watch skating anymore. And I was really thrilled for Davis and White. I was really impressed by them. The amount of pressure that they must have been under, and they were really wonderful in both programs. And the Scheherazade program in particular has gotten really strong. When they first debuted it in Salt Lake City, I thought it was nice, you know, but I thought like that's Bloomberg and Siebert's music. But by Nationals, like that program got good. And it's a really strong program. It's improved tremendously. And I was a little bit nervous for them before the Olympics, like leaving aside the like Heap article. In the weeks before the event, I was getting a real like Michelle Kwan pre-Nagano vibe from the media coverage, this idea that it was a sure bet and that they couldn't lose. So that was worrisome. But they were amazing. And it's such good news for U.S. figure skating, I think. And it's a really important win. And I can't believe that it's 2014 in ice dance. And they really went the whole year without making a mistake. I mean, it's incredible. Davis and White, what about you?
Yeah, I was really excited. I know what you mean about the Michelle Kwan vibe. Actually, in Salt Lake City, we were sitting there watching it. We were having that same discussion. Is this Michelle Kwan at Skate America before the whole year and how it felt that same way? I also agree that the program has gotten better both times. I remember I saw Scheherazade in person and I was so excited to see them skate live, debut their programs. And then I went home and I digested it. And of course, I rewatched the YouTube videos a bunch of times to really dissect these programs and analyze. And I felt like something was missing. And I felt throughout the year that the program at first, then I thought that there wasn't enough emotion at Skate America. And I stand by that. And then I thought that the program got better and better and better, like their program did last year. I thought that Notre Dame de Paris, I remember being really excited about the music choice and then seeing the program being like, Skate America, and then by Worlds it was leaving you like breathless, you know, like, and it was, I felt the same way with Scheherazade. I find it really funny though that in the Russian commentator they have two different broadcasts. There's one with Trosva and one with Peter Chernyshev, and they both commented that Davis and White don't do crossovers. And if you read any of the Canadian media, they will say nothing that Davis and White, the program is all crossovers, and they will say that they don't get any of their power from crossovers is what the Russians were saying. And we generally look to the Russians as the leaders in ice dance. So I thought that was fascinating commentary because it's just, it leaves so many things. And one thing I did do is I made a tally because I have a blog, and as you know, and I get the same comments written on that then show up in like Bev Smith articles that like fans write, that write on like the Virtue and Moyer Tumblr or the Davis and White Tumblr. And they were writing about how they both do hops and that's how Merrill and Charlie gain speed. And I noticed that both teams do about the same number of hops in their step sequences. And they both are actually on to the music. It doesn't look like they actually really need them to generate power. It looks like it's actually like on the beat and it's more of a choreographic touch. But that was such a big deal, the fact that that was done this year. And I watched their old programs and these year's programs, and I don't feel like either team's skating has deteriorated and that they are suddenly relying on hops. So I found that that was really interesting that they both, Tessa skips a couple of times in the program. They both come diagonally down the ice at one point towards the judges and do a little bit of skipping. Meryl and Charlie weave back and forth. Tessa and Scott kind of go forwards. And I thought it was really just interesting that so many of the criticisms that one camp will make about the other team, they both do. They both have the same coaches and choreographers. So, and another thing that Tarasova really said was that she's like, everyone's saying that these are Zueva's teams, but Spielbon was the technician, and we should not forget that they were with him for so many years and that they are really his teams in terms of technique. And I thought that that was interesting. I was really impressed that both teams skated so well in both portions of the event. I actually really loved the Canadians' short dance. It was just such a performance.
I think the short dance is it's exceptional, and especially God, that opening non-touch footwork sequence.
The
I
edges
mean,
were so deep and
it just
so
it
smooth.
knocks you over. It's so perfect. I mean, the curves, the deep edges, the unison. It's just oh, it kills me.
Yeah, and I think maybe the point difference shouldn't have been as great in the short dance. I mean, I'm not going to claim that I saw Scott mess up focal point number three on the first fin step, but apparently it happened. I know that the Finns, Rocamo and Coco, felt that they were stronger in the actual fin step. I mean, that is one of the elements, not all of the elements in
Well,
there.
I thought that Rocamo, that I first of all, I love them.
Yes.
If you have never seen their Finlandia free dance 1993 World Championships, pause this video. Don't need go. I mean, when I was a child, they were my one of my absolute favorite teams. Anyway, he said that he felt that Bertrand Moore captured the feeling of the fin step more when he originally created it, or when they created it. But I do think that the fin step, for better or worse, probably for worse, is really reduced down to the key points at this, now. And I haven't been able to watch the video since I saw it live. And so I don't know if Scott missed a key point. I will say, I think that I do feel like Bertrand Moore and Davis and White dance the fin step differently. I think Davis and White are very bouncy, and Bertrand Moore are very elegant and smooth. And so,
It's preference.
yeah, it is.
It's kind of like cake frosting versus like red wine to me, a little bit during, like if you want it like light and fluffy and fun, is that your fin step? And it's a totally different character. And to me, that goes back to the fact of why I hate the short dance so much, is because we're criticizing someone's interpretation of the fin step. And back in the day, when people used to do a compulsory pattern, everyone used the same music. And now people are using music that's entirely different in character, it's entirely different in rhythm, the stylization of the fin step is different. And I find it really difficult to compare what Peychalat and Borzas are doing compared to what Ilyinik and Katsalapov are doing, or Davis and White. It's a completely different program. They're doing the same steps, but it doesn't seem the same to me. The rhythm is different. People abuse the rhythm, or it's not the same. And to me, it's really hard to make a really valid argument and comparison when they're doing that. I just think it's such a mess of a discipline. It's such a mess of a program to me that I really hate the short dance, and I was
I
glad when
think
it was over.
this was a more difficult of the last 4 years. This was, I think, one of the more challenging patterns to incorporate without grinding the program to a halt.
To me, it was just that. In terms of the free dance, I thought that both teams were absolutely wonderful. I think it's one of those things that comes down to personal preference. I found it interesting that 7-2 put Davis and White actually ahead in the short dance, and 6-2 did in the free dance, and one judge tied them in terms of components, and they had the same number of +3s and +2s by that judge. And it was
Look at
just,
you.
I know, I because you know what, I was getting into the media about how if the U.S. traded votes with the Russians, and I thought, well, that's interesting. It's entirely plausible that it could have happened. Absolutely, every country is trying to politic. It's ice dance. It's entirely possible that this happened, right? Do I think that it happened and made the difference? No. But it was impossible. And I'm like, well, then they would have had to make deals with every single judge on the panel, just about, when every judge is giving them tens. And I thought that this had less to do with politics and more to do with the fact that ice dance is subjective, and that over a 2.5-year period, Davis and White have barely ever made a mistake. And if it's been a
Right.
mistake, it's been from a level 4 to a level 3. And that they haven't had noticeable errors besides like unison on twizzles or minor errors.
Yeah.
Whereas when you watch Tessa and Scott, I think what happened is that they started making mistakes. And I know that she has had problems with her shins and perhaps they don't train as many hours. But I
Yeah.
think that they lost the battle in perception about 2 years ago. They won a title in Nice that is debatable whether or not they should have won because they made mistakes in their free dance. And it wasn't something that affected levels, but it did affect the overall cohesiveness and performance execution. And then they show up. They took months off during that summer when Davis and White did not. And they were already neck and neck. And I think that you look back, why did you take those months off if you're going to whine now? Because during that time, Davis and White got ready for last season where they were undefeated. Virtue and Moyer showed up to Carmen in October at Skate Canada and had tons of errors and a very sloppy second half of that free dance. They were then sloppy at their next Grand Prix event. They pulled out midway through, and had to stop at Four Continents. And even though they thought that they should have won Worlds, there were choreographic touches that were sloppy there, like when they do the thing and she dropped her leg, and they just were never crisp. And they made a lot of errors on twizzle sequences this year. And I think if you make enough mistakes from again and again and again, people aren't going to still believe that you're inherently superior. They now expect you to make mistakes. They expect you to finish in second place. And I think that they lost a little bit of battle of there. And then it comes down to music choice and which program you feel is more important. And I personally feel that Scheherazade was more inspired than the seasons. And the music I felt was more gripping.
Yeah.
Whether or not you like whichever team better, I think that the actual program was a little bit more captivating in some way, in the same way that I felt that Mahler left me breathless in 2010.
Yeah.
When I watch it, I'm still like, I still feel like, oh my God, like I can watch Phantom of the Opera and be like, that's amazing. And then you put on Mahler and I'm like, okay, like that was a 10. That was fantastic. And I think that with the seasons, it never felt inspired to me and it always felt phoned in. I don't know.
I think that I agree. I think it never the seasons never came together. And I think this morning in the press conference, Scott even said that he felt like they were in quicksand all year with that program. And I felt that way too, watching it throughout the year. I could feel their concern, and there were a lot of modifications to the program, and it did feel to me like they were scrambling. And I understand why they wanted to go back to like a vintage Virtue and Moore style for the Olympic year, especially after losing at Worlds, where they were trying Carmen, which is a much more ambitious program. And I think a lot of the problem with this program is the music, and I don't know if it's the cuts or if it's just music that isn't really can't successfully be cut down to 4 minutes, but I don't feel that it really lifted them the way that the Mahler program did. And I when they anytime they skated this program outside of Canada this year, I felt like it really fell flat.
Where were the highs and the lows? Because they always talk about how it's the highs and the lows of their career, and I always felt that the music was one note. And I felt that whereas Mahler, I felt like took you on a journey, I felt like the whole issue with this program is that it felt like a sequel and it felt like Sex and the City 2, where it just felt like, we're going to make a couple millions at the box office or we're going to get another metal here, but it never felt inspired the way Mahler felt like they had this great idea. It came from the music. It just, like I imagine the choreography coming together really quickly, where this one felt like there was a lot of thought that went into it and it never was an organic idea. So,
Okay, yeah,
but what
I
did
would
you
agree with that.
think about them then putting the blame on Marina today? Because up until this point, the Canadian media has said a lot, but Virtue and Moyer did not, and people were saying that they were being very classy. And then today.
Okay, first of all, like, well, this morning I saw all these headlines that, Virtue and Moore slam coach, and I thought, like, that's, sour grapes, and it's, Davis and White were really gracious 4 years ago when the shoe was on the other foot. But then I saw on Twitter, and somebody had linked to the video of the press conference, and it really was not that bad. They were really, it was really taken out of context, and they were being asked questions like, did you go to Marina and where you were concerned about how your program wasn't getting enough points this year? And then Scott would say, yeah, we went to Marina and we said, we're worried the program isn't getting enough points. And I didn't, the tone didn't feel like malicious to me or bitter. It felt like very reflective. So I was happy to see that. It didn't, it wasn't as bad as it was
Well,
portrayed. It
because when
wasn't,
you read it in the articles, it
it,
comes
yeah.
across very strongly.
Yeah, I mean, the one thing he did, he was sort of hard on her for not going to their nationals and for not walking with them in the opening ceremonies, or not walking with the Americans instead, I guess. And there were parts of it that were probably inelegantly phrased, but it wasn't bad. I just
I think that if she did make a bet on a team, maybe it had to do with more with the fact that Davis and White seemed like a sure bet because they've always been prepared for competition. And Tessa and Scott have not always showed up trained or as in shape over the last couple of years. And I think that if you're being really honest about it, there have been times that Tessa and Scott showed up sloppy, and maybe Marina responds to that. But I think that if they had an issue with Marina, they could have left. This is ice dance. There is going to be an arrogant Russian woman somewhere who has connections to judges and would gladly take the credit for someone, the way that Tarasova gladly took credit for Klimova and Ponomarenko in '92
Yeah,
when she was
it's
really the choreographer and that other woman was the one who coached them. It's such a joke to me. Did they stay with Marina because they felt that if they left, Virtue and Moyer were going to win for, I mean, that Davis and White would win for sure because Marina had more votes? Is that like what this is all about?
I don't know if it's about votes. I think maybe about a perception of weakness and this idea that if you're the team that leaves, that means that you're not the number one team in your own coach's eyes. I mean, that's totally speculation. I have no idea. I did expect, not expect, I thought it was very likely that whoever lost Worlds last year would end up leaving. It's actually very, it's astonishing that they have stayed together like this for as many years as they have. I mean, you look at like Linichuk with Grichuk and Platov, and Krylova and Ovsyannikov, and then Dubova with Klimova and Ponomarenko and Usova and Zulin. Like, it doesn't work. This is really a situation where you need your team behind you, and you need somebody who's going to be advocating for you tirelessly in the press and behind the scenes. And so it's incredible to me that it has worked out as well as it has. I'm sure that Virtue and Moore, maybe they feel it hasn't worked out. But it worked out 4 years ago.
Well, I thought that was interesting that they said that they felt that Marina was in their corner 4 years ago because people argue that Bollywood should have won the OD at the Olympics, and was
Yeah.
Marina pulling for them because the win was in Canada and that was more valuable to have the Canadians win at home? And there was been always been speculation of what side, she's been playing, and I thought, well, I thought that was funny when they suggested that the US Federation was the one that was politicking, because in dance over the years, you always hear about the coach being the one who's really pulling the strings with the judges, Linichuk, Tarasova. It's never the Russian Federation. It's always like Tarasova is pulling the strings, or Grishuk and Platov. Linichuk is pulling the strings. Marina, Igor. And I think that that is really interesting. And I thought immediately, well, maybe they should redirect their anger toward Marina, who Canada always gave all of the credit to when she was working with Igor. And then this article came out today. So I wasn't surprised that eventually it went there, but I thought it was interesting. I have to say that I'm disappointed in the Canadian media.
Okay.
Not surprised, but disappointed.
Okay.
Because, first of all, Canada is relying on an anonymous tip from an article in France, in a French paper. France screwed Canada in 2002, just in case anyone was paying attention. It was France that did that. And now all of a sudden they love France. And I feel like over the last 8 years, Canada got very politically savvy when they started their Own the Podium campaign, and they knew that they were going to host the Olympics. And they were always extremely behind the IJS when it since its inception, partially because of Sally and Peltier, and partially, I believe, it helped them with Otavio and the ISU. Once they started getting behind that IJS, they started doing better internationally, and they certainly had momentum. And it seems like they've gotten more and more vocal. And it's almost like a Fox News situation where there are certain Canadian writers, and they were always Team Canada. They never criticize a Canadian skater ever. And it's Rosie DiMaggio, Bev Smith, Steve Milton. Sometimes PJ Kwong can be very, when she wrote that pro Caitlin Osmond piece last year, saying that she was going to win four continents, and what she said about the cheese and Virtue and Moyer versus Davis and White last year. And they usually will always quote, if they're doing a positive or negative piece, the list of scorned Canadian skaters, which will be Elvis Stoiko or Liz Manley. And then if they want like a kind of impartial quote, they'll go for Kurt Browning. And then usually if they want to promote one of their skaters like Virgin Moyer, they'll go for a European that they know likes Virgin Moyer. And then there is your article. And then it's just like all the time. And it's astonishing to me. It seems like they're competing for access and they know that they're like on a sports team and it's very, it feels like propaganda almost. And all the articles are very similar in tone, and I just, you see it over and over and over again. And Bev Smith was saying that Meryl and Charlie should have lost levels for their twizzles, and I said, well, because they were out of unison. And I'm like, that's something that like a young fan tweeted at me, and I was like, well, actually, that's a GOE. And right. You know, Bev Smith, you're a journalist about skating, like you should know this instead of, and take, you know, 5 minutes to verify that. So I'm very interested that why every time a Canadian loses a gold medal, is it a conspiracy in skating?
Yeah.
Sorry for that rant, but
I think for me, I mean, beyond the Canadian issue, it's very hard when you're when you follow a sport, you're in a sport, mm-hmm. and you have a lot of knowledge, and then mm-hmm. a sport that is as, you know, small scale, I guess, mm-hmm. As skating, and then every 4 years it attracts a lot of mainstream attention and reporters who have no base knowledge of the subject are all of a sudden writing about it. And you realize when you read the articles, like how much context is missing, how much background information, a lot of just straight up factual inaccuracies. And all the fix articles, I just felt like were very lazy and no exploration of like how that would really work. Mm-hmm. I don't know. It's a larger issue than just this one story, but it's hard during the Olympics to, you know, digest a lot of the coverage.
I just find it interesting how much they are willing to attack Davis and White. And I have always felt that the Americans, at least during skating's heyday, really embraced the Canadian skaters. And yeah. We were very supportive of Sally and Peltier. We were very supportive of Kurt Browning, even when they were competing against American skaters. I don't remember the U.S. media tearing down Brian Orser. I don't remember the U.S. media ever even going after Elvis Stoiko, even when he was against Todd Eldridge. And we certainly mm-hmm. could have used style as an example for why Todd should be superior to Elvis, or something like spins, or so, you know, along those lines. So I find it really interesting that every time, you know, Elvis lost, or every time Borden Kratz lost, or anyone lost, it was always a giant conspiracy against Canada. And they, I know that as a country, they're thought to have, you know, chip on their shoulder about the U.S. And it's just, it's interesting to me how it has worked out. You know, there have been ice dancers who have switched countries to Canada and then made worlds the year before and then not made the Olympics. And it's just, it's very interesting to me that it just continues. And it felt like we knew it was coming, like they could not accept a loss, whether or not, you know. And it's ice dance, it's subjective. To say that Virtue and Moyer are inherently better because Tessa Virtue has better extension and yeah. they have perhaps deeper edges, but are slower and less trained, that they're inherently better just because they didn't make a mistake, to me is really arrogant, I find. Because to me, I felt watching the free dance that it could have gone either way. But to say that it's automatically a fix bothers me, I think, on a level of how quickly they were. And I know that it's not all of the media, perhaps, that's so strongly, but it is their skating Fox News press that's really getting in there to doing the good work for the Federation. And the Federation can sit back and then yeah. not say anything, but then these writers will get more access for their in the future. So I think that it's interesting. But it feels like a team. And I always wonder, what would Bev Smith or PJ, what would they do about Jeremy Abbott? Would they write articles the same way that Christine Brennan and Phil Hirsch cover Jeremy?
I doubt it.
You know,
I don't know.
I mean, maybe it's just a difference in culture, but mm-hmm. I think it's just interesting to me. Like, mm-hmm. I feel like we're much harsher on our skaters than they are. So, I don't know, but moving along. you have something to say? Yeah.
No, I was going to say, they support their skaters mm-hmm. regardless. And they have a lot of success.
That's true. Yeah. Moving on to the bronze medal race, this was another hotly debated competition all year. We were waiting for it. It was predicted a Russian team was going to get that bronze medal no matter what, and Ilyinikin Katsalapov wound up on the podium in the bronze medal position. Were you surprised? And what did you think of the bronze medal race?
Oh my God, Dave. Okay, no, I was not surprised. It was still disappointing. You know, I got my hopes up with that 72 in the short dance for mm-hmm. Pechelat and Borzat, just to have them cruelly dashed. you know, it's no secret that I'm a really big fan of this free dance from Pechelat and Borzat. I think it's the best free dance of the year. I mean, Weaver and Poget also have a very strong free dance. Mm-hmm. I think the Ilyinich and Katsalapov program is very, it's very good. It's very grand in scale, and it's very accessible, and I think it's easy to watch. I think if you break it down mm-hmm. to things like transitions and two-foot skating and footwork sequences, I don't think there really is a comparison. Mm-hmm. I think the French program is much stronger. It's more complete. It's more interesting. Mm-hmm. But no, I mean, I wasn't surprised that it played out this way. I think Ilyinich and Katsalapov looked very strong to me this whole event. They look trained. And I think that usually when you watch them, I feel uneasy and I'm waiting for something to happen, mm-hmm. something, you know, a fall. And I didn't feel that way this mm-hmm. time watching them. I thought they were very secure and very trained for the first time in a long time. Mm-hmm. I mean, we could talk about the component scores. It's probably not worth it. I mean, Dave, the French, they lost to Bobrova and Soloviev on component scores.
I mean, it was in Russia. Hello. Yeah. How many events have we sat through in Russia before? And that's the way I was not surprised in that way. I felt that a Russian was going to get on the podium, so I got on the Ilyinich train because I could not handle the alternative down to my soul. I don't think that Bobrova looks like fifth place. I think maybe she could be a good rival for the Shibutanis or Madison Chalk, but I felt that in terms of the bronze medal, Bobrova's program was just shuddering of fear to me. But for Ilyinich against Pechelat and Borzat, I wondered if, at first I'm like, well, maybe the French program is too artsy, because I have not read The Little Prince. I would love to say that I have not. I can't pretend.
Thank you, I appreciate, you know,
but the honesty. I thought maybe it was too artsy, maybe it's too avant-garde and not accessible enough. Swan Lake is just so accessible. Who doesn't know Swan Lake? Except for people that I date. But I felt like Ilyinich and Katsalapov, you know, that program is so well known. But then I thought, it didn't matter no matter what. I mean, even Tracy Wilson was trying to explain that maybe Ilyinich, I mean, it came down to like charisma and energy. And I mean, in terms of skating quality, I think you have to go for Pechelat and Borzat. But I think that this event was judged on energy and the future and politics, and I believe that Ilyinich will be a wonderful ice dance diva for years to come. Mm-hmm. There will be loads of skating scandals in terms of results that maybe are inaccurate. I think ice dance is going to swing a little bit back towards the days of Navka and Pasha, and when we kind of squinted at the results. I think that it is on the way. I think that order has been restored. Ilyinich is now on top. This was like a graduation to me, and I felt that teams got out of the way, and Russia is back on top of ice dance, and you better believe it. And that this girl is our new ice dance diva. Putin was there scouting out perhaps his new Kabaeva, and I felt that it was a really strong message about what we're in store for the next 4 years. I didn't think it had much to do with the actual skating, I have to say.
Yeah. I mean, I think I'm so disappointed. I mean, it wouldn't be ice dance if it didn't completely break your heart. But I thought, you know, I think we'll see fewer and fewer programs like this program from the French. I think you'll see more and more programs like the Swan Lake program. I mean, why do a program like this? It's not rewarded. It's not valued. But I did get the sense that they did it for the personal satisfaction of doing it, and because it was important for them to make something that they cared about. So that's definitely worth something for me.
I felt I was talking to some ice dancers that I will, you know, confer to about results, and they were saying that, you know, Pechelat and Borzoi, they are kind of that IJS style team where they're still really together in the program. And she was saying something about the top teams is that the IJS, because it's so difficult, you almost learn how to emotionally disengage when you're doing the elements, and then you try to present, but you have to kind of switch on and off, and instead of being really present. And the one thing that when you watch the French is that they're really together throughout their step sequences, and they're not as complex perhaps, or they're not as fast and not as much going on, but they're deeper edges and they're more together, and there's more of an actual connection versus a, you know, a put-on connection. I thought that was interesting about how you have to disengage, do some of these elements. But what did you think about the other teams? I was really happy that Weaver and Poche finished fifth, I believe, in the free dance, but I felt overall is that's where they deserve to be. I was sad to see them screwed in the short dance, but I saw it coming before the Grand Prix final, so I didn't have my hopes up. I thought that the Europeans would do everything that they could to make sure that there was no chance of a North American sweep. And that I felt that Weaver and Poche were fighting a losing battle all year. I do worry about them for the future, because I think that there will be some repercussions for America and Canada being on top for so many years in a row. I think that the pendulum is going to swing the other way. But what did you think about Capellini Linote? Because this is something that has been really interesting, is that they kind of got dumped by the judges here, and that there were a lot of criticisms of them that came out. Tatiana Tarasova said that they get points for her face. I thought that was interesting. Johnny Weir was also not a big fan of the Italians. All year I have really enjoyed them. I thought that maybe they didn't have their best skates here, but I thought that they were a team of quality. What did you think?
Yeah, I'm surprised to hear that Tarasova said that. I don't know if she sees them as a threat going forward. They were wonderful here. I'm on record, I love this program as well. I think it's very difficult. What did you tweet? You tweeted something about how comedy never wins the Oscar.
It rarely wins the Oscar. Yeah. And Lighthearted rarely wins the Oscar, and I feel that it rarely wins an ice dance. And I think even if you look at one and two, drama sells. And I feel that way strongly in ice dance, that Funny Face was the anomaly. It was not the routine.
The rule,
in terms
of,
you know, what wins. And I think that Davidson White having a more dramatic program is something that just more gripping to ice dance judges. I don't know. I think it's the way the sport goes. I wouldn't go out there and put what the Italians did out. I think that it's not kind of the usual route to success in terms of...
It's so difficult.
It is. But also going forward, one of the things is that I want to talk to you about the Shibutanis, because people have all sorts of feelings on them and about this Michael Jackson program. I, for one, never thought that it fit them. I thought that they are a very controlled team with a lot of hold, and that they're more of a sweeping, kind of more old school team that's more kind of like a waltz. And it always confused me that they seemed to be two serious kids trying to loosen up to Michael Jackson, but it never played off to me. So I wonder, going forward, they're obviously in line to be Marina Zoeva's top team. Do you think that that'll help up and that they will be back in the bronze medal mix in the future?
Well, Marina has some availability now with her teams, likely retiring, her top two teams. And I think that there will be other teams who will look to her. I think if you're in that situation, if you are a team like the Shibutanis in Detroit, I think the idea of leaving Detroit must just seem like incomprehensible. And I think, you know, I would love to see what some other choreographers could do with them, because I think that they have a lot of really wonderful qualities.
Yeah.
I think they have nice lines. I think that they're well matched. I mean, I think the Michael Jackson program, it really fell flat here in Sochi, but I also think, I mean, the Sochi audience was not really very kind to any of the teams, the non-Russian teams. I mean, they didn't even give the top two standing ovations. But I felt, you know, they had the one mistake in the free dance here, and it really fell flat after that.
Okay.
And this is a program I think Alex really loves to skate it. And Maya seems a little bit, she's totally a good sport about it. But I don't think it's, really her style.
Yeah.
I don't know. Those are a few thoughts.
Yeah, I would really like to see what kind of the out-of-the-box choreographer, if they could go skate with Papadakis and Cizeron for a while and maybe even just get the program from Zazui. I think it would be interesting to see what would happen if just like a totally fresh set of eyes took a look at this team and said, what can I do? I think maybe they need to go really artsy, really out-of-the-box, just do something. I think they need to get away from Arena. I think that they were dumped 3 years ago after that bronze medal. You can be polite about it or claim that they made it, they got dumped by the judges. Forget after they got that bronze medal. And I feel that their skating has kind of been ignored and that it hasn't developed in 3 years. Perhaps the way I feel like their best free dance was in 2011. I felt that that was their best program and that they've never come close to it since. And that they're a talented team. And it's unfortunate that I felt like this was such a wrong step. I knew it. The second I got the text message that they were skating to Michael Jackson, I'm like, they're fighting the youth card. And this is just wrong. This is not a good idea, you know, knowing their style of skating. So I think it's interesting. I think they do need a fresh set of eyes. I think that people may need to leave Detroit a bit and search for new choreographic ideas and opportunities, because I think that everyone staying the same didn't work for Virtue and Moyer, and I don't think that necessarily it's going to work in the future.
I think eventually there will be a shift. I don't think I kind of think it'll probably get worse before it gets better. I think there will be more and more teams in Detroit over the next 4 years, including probably some Russian teams. But the Shibutanis are really, really good. And so I want the best for them. And I hope, I don't know, I mean, I assume they'll be continuing. So we'll see.
Yeah. It feels like they've been like waiting to be Marina's top team. And I just worry that another team will get pulled in there and moved up ahead of them. It's just one of those things where you're seeing the accident before it happens and seeing what has happened to other teams in the past. And I watched their programs and I felt like they've wasted 3 years of their lives with coaches who may not have made them a priority, and that they could have better programs and better material. I didn't feel that their material was as good as the skaters that they are. So I think looking forward, I would hope that they can get some better programs. And I don't even know if they know it about their programs or what they need to do, but I think just a completely fresh set of eyes that has nothing to do with Marina or Igor. I think Krylova has enough teams, so I think they need to really look elsewhere. Maybe they can go to Seattle to get programs. I don't know. We can.
That is a great idea.
I really think they need to think outside of the box, but I certainly cannot wait to discuss ice dance at the World Championships. Emily, I have a feeling that Worlds is going to be such an interesting event in ice dance. I feel like that is where the shade is going to go down, I have to think.
We'll see.
But as always, we want to remind you to hold an edge and look sexy. Bye, guys.
Bye.